Back to the Future trilogy, now available on DVD and Blu-ray, and probably VHS, and also Betamax, and likely Laserdisc. Then stop by the Universal Store and buy their t-shirts, buy their hats, buy all the shit that you don't need. Buy as much crap as you possibly can so that this free plug keeps my movie from getting knocked off the YouTube.
Are we back? We're back.
My calculations are correct. When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're gonna see some serious stuff.
Drop it.
Back to the Future, the myth, the legend. It was by far one of the best movies of the 1980s, and of the 1950s, and of the 1880s. Fuck, it's one of the best movies ever made. How can anybody watch the trilogy and not love it? I don't think I've ever met a person who didn't. If there was such a person, there's a good chance they're fucking retarded. It's not just a movie that visits various eras such as the 50s and the 1800s. It's actually like a time capsule of the 1980s. Watching it in current day is like traveling back to an important era in human history. The 1980s was an important decade. It ushered in concepts like personal computers, portable communications, and bushy pubic hair. And it was a decade where four-fifths of it was run by a famous actor of the black and white era. A decade where cocaine was spread so wide across the country that a swift breeze got people high. And running alongside the president was his wife, Nancy Reagan, and her Just Say No campaign to fight the drug war, a campaign that would spread across television and arcade games. Arcade games like Bad Dudes, where you have to save a kidnapped Ronald Reagan. Or Narc, a game about two police officers in opposing colors committing an inner-city genocide of drug dealers. It was an era where television and other media was trying to tone down the party-hard eras of the decades before it. It was hip to be square, which was a song by Huey Lewis and the News, the same guy who did a number of songs in Back to the Future. It starred a clean, good-looking white kid named Marty McFly, a non-drug-using, non-smoking, non-drinking vegetarian. Well, Michael J. Fox is a vegetarian. Don't know about Marty. Not like it matters. The point is, it was a classic, boring as shit, plain white kid character, like pretty much every teen character that was in a movie in the 1980s. Back then, black teen characters were bumped down to supporting roles of smiling nitwits that were used as serial killer fodder.
Shit. Motherfucker.
Falcon Punch!
Which thankfully has changed with time, saving black character deaths until maybe the second or third in the film. Also, Latin Americans didn't exist in the 1980s. Which is somewhat amusing, as Hill Valley is a rundown town in California. Rundown towns are where California puts all their Latinos when it's not using them for low-wage jobs, or feel the need to make casually racist comments while they're working. But Hill Valley is all white. Unless it's the alternate 1985, then there's some color. Enjoy your stereotypes, Uncle Ben. The story to Back to the Future is simple. It's a classic story of love and self-discovery and science, wonder, incest, perversion, greed, animal feces, and the relationship between a 71-year-old single man and a sexy young 17-year-old boy. Dr. Emmett Brown is a scientist who's apparently infamous and has an infamous nature about him, as Mr. Strickland has words with Marty about him. He tells Marty he shouldn't hang around with him, but maybe that's because he's a 17-year-old boy and Dr. Brown is a 70-year-old or 71-year-old single white guy. So the trilogy starts off with, you know, a hint of what's gonna come. You know, it starts off with the clocks. Lots and lots and lots and lots of fucking clocks. Which all go batshit when Marty gets there. The TV has a vague description of a nuclear plant break and there's a plutonium theft and hey, a little note of trivia. In recent years, when this part is shown on TV, they actually removed the references to terrorists and terrorisms. Because apparently since 9/11, if you say the word terrorism, Al-Qaeda operatives appear in your house like fucking Beetlejuice. So there's a big fat plop of dog food and Marty shows up, lends himself in with a key. I'm gonna have to ask why he has a key to Doc's place. Does he just let himself in often? Who knows? It's awkward, but, you know, it's another era and the overtones of man-boy love wasn't as noticed as it is today. So, Marty comes in and destroys Doc's home when the phone rings. Doc requests a supple young boy to meet him in a dark parking lot at 1 in the morning with a camcorder. Okay, now this is just getting weird. Saying it out loud makes it even sillier. Oh, shit, I'm late for school. A quick Burger King product placement, and Marty takes off to risk his safety on a skateboard. He passes a dance studio, then a quick product placement for Mountain Dew, and he shows up for school. Now I'm going to put the plot on pause while I tell you an intimate detail about why you should love Marty McFly. Marty is the epitome of the classic American male teen. He's into girls and video games, and according to the cheesy fucking poster in his room, he's into sports, he skateboards, he drinks Pepsi Free, which is a caffeine-free Pepsi introduced in 1982 and then phased out by 1987, mostly because it tastes really fucking disgusting. In fact, it tastes like Pepsi, so It was pretty nasty. Which is actually one of the most clever jokes later in the film that not too many people are going to understand, especially a younger generation. Marty is impulsive, he's quick to make bad decisions, and he has trouble understanding his parents. The classic teenage character. And he's played by Michael J. Fox, by far one of the most talented actors of the 1980s. Although that wasn't always the case. You see, the director, Robert Zemeckis, wanted Michael J. Fox from the start. However, Michael J. Fox was busy with a sitcom called Family Ties, which he was on at that time. So they picked up his doppelganger, Eric Stoltz. They filmed a great deal of the movie with him, and then according to Zemeckis, Stoltz just wasn't exactly what they needed, and blah, 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 blah. Translation, he sucked, and they wanted Michael J. Fox. And they got him. And the character exists forever and ever as an icon of the timeless nature of the teenage boy, no matter what decade of his birth. Michael J. Fox is pure awesome. In fact, I suggest replacing Chuck Norris jokes with Michael J. Fox jokes, since, you know, Chuck Norris has turned into a batshit right-wing evangelical. Michael J. Fox joke. Oh! Michael J. Fox doesn't have Parkinson's. He's just so awesome that he vibrates between two universes. Alright, I got it started off. Anywho, back to the first chapter of the Trilogy of Awesome. Marty shows up at school and gets accosted by the old guy from the Six Flags commercial. And he gets a demerit for some reason and an inspirational word from an educator.
Don't bother, McFly. You don't have a chance. You're too much like your old man. No McFly ever amounted to anything in the history of Hill Valley.
Then he tries to apparently make out with Marty, and they're off to the gym to watch Marty play music with the cast of Wayne's World. He Huey Lewis plays a cameo as a pedophile with a microphone and tells Marty and his band to fuck off. Marty and Lady go to the town square where this old bag of a bitch interrupts their private intimate moment. And fuck you, Lady. Jennifer's dad pulls up in a classy wood grain brown eye fuck of a car. And she gives Marty his the grandma's number. That's what she gave him. His number's actually been changed a few times on TV. Not quite sure why. Anyway, Marty sees shows up at a home and he sees a tow truck. And we meet George McFly, played by Crispin, I'm out of my fucking mind Glover, and Tom Fuck This Movie typecasted me forever Wilson. Wearing the spring collection from Creepy Uncles RS. We learned that the big, stupid, drunken idiot, Biff, crashed George's car, and then George pussies out about confronting him. Marty tells his dad that he's a bitch and he takes off. And then we're off to dinner, where we learned that Marty's family sucks and they're all fucking horrible people. We have Pedo Dad, Drunken Mom, Burger King Brother, and Velma from Scooby-Doo. We're informed that their extended family sucks too, as their uncle is in prison and being denied parole. Sucks to be you, Uncle Joey. Marty falls asleep fist deep in his own ass when the telephone rings. Dr. Brown drops a booty call and Marty's off to meet him. In the middle of the night. In a parking lot. With a camcorder. He arrives at the Twin Pines Mall, which later in the movie will be called the Lone Pines Mall, since Marty destroys one of the pines with the car. Oh, hello, unsupervised dog. What's that? Oh my fucking god, it's a DeLorean that appears to have driven through a Radio Shack. The DeLorean car, or the DMC-12, was an extremely overpriced car released at the beginning of the 1980s by John DeLorean. Looking at the car, it's nothing special for that era. It looked pretty much like every other car. However, it retailed at a phenomenally large price, $12,000, or $64,000 in today dollars. That's twice as much as the base model of a BMW. It featured a stainless steel design and a very unique set of gull-wing doors, which were very uncommon for that era. John DeLorean was an automotive designer who had worked on cars like the Firebird or the GTO, cars very popular in the pre-DMC days. He believed that his car and his car company could compete in an open market with the dwindling American auto sales and the ever-increasing Japanese car sales. He was wrong. His company sold about half of what they needed just to break even. He even tried to drum up investors and failed. Then, he attempted to bring $25 million worth of cocaine into the United States in an effort to save his dying company. Nearly $60 million in today. He was caught but was found not guilty due to a technicality. He died still making promises of a comeback that was never to be. And even though the company tanked, their car was used in Back to the Future. Although they originally wanted to go with a refrigerator, but they realized that that was a really fucking stupid idea and only a stupid, shitty movie would try to do something that lame and dumb. Dr. Brown jumps out and eyes ablaze because I guess he seemed to have tracked down some of that great 1980s coke. And then proceeds to strap the dog in and drive him around with a remote control. And let's see, then BOOM! Off to an obvious green screen. Just out of curiosity, why did they have to stand in front of the car? What the fuck did that prove? I mean, Dr. Brown goes on at length later in the film about how everything he touches turns to shit. I wouldn't be so cocky to think that after 71 years of failure, that this would be the one time that things go right. And he even looks shocked as shit when it works. Doc jumps around and Marty looks around like he smelled a fart and the obvious puddles of gasoline burn off. Thank you, Blu-ray. The car comes back through time and is covered with ice. Why in the fuck is this thing covered with ice is a mystery. It seems kind of stupid to me. I mean, it blows out when it takes off and it shoots flames, but then on the other side instantaneously it's surrounded by ice? I'm not a scientific mind by any means, but I do know that heating something up and then plunging it into cold causes it to shatter. Thank you, Bill Nye, the science guy's guy. But fuck it, this isn't a realistic movie. I can overlook it. But since I am nitpicking, wouldn't a 1,500 pound of steel suddenly appearing out of thin air, wouldn't that spread the gases out around it, blowing Doc and Marty on their asses? Alright, not realistic, calm down.
Hello, this is Dog!
They replace the plutonium and Doc is off to time travel. He forgets the plutonium that he just used moments beforehand when the terrorists show up. Now this kind of irks me. I mean, he's done a total of one test with the car, and now he's about to take an entire case of volatile nuclear... Now he's about to take an entire case of volatile nuclear matter and stick it in a machine and that violently blasts through time. Doesn't that risk the chance of blowing the fuck up? Or worse yet, blowing up in the time period that they're showing up? Ugh, not realistic. And then a white guy in a Latino dress like Middle Easterners show up in the world's most agile vehicle, the Volkswagen microbus. They shoot Doc, then they try to shoot Marty. His gun jams, but Marty does a flying leap into the DeLorean, and what follows is by far one of the best car chases in cinematic history. It's not very long, but it's awesome as hell. And Marty blasts through the time barrier and ends up in November 5th, 1955. Now comes one of my biggest pet peeves when dealing with Back to the Future. Now, Marty leaves 1985 on October 22nd. He pops out in the exact same spot in 1955. The problem with this is, as time goes by, the planet follows an orbit around the sun. So, were you to travel through time to the exact same spot, you'd end up missing the planet entirely and float off through space. However, instead of this, we find Marty crashing into a barn. They think he's from outer space and shoot him. He runs over one of the trees, and hence the reason Twin Pine Mall becomes Lone Pine Mall later in the film. He makes his way to Hill Valley. In the past, I guess it looks like a Norman Rockwell painting. Back to the Future also hasn't exactly had the luck of the draw when dealing with video games. It's had some of the worst game titles in human history. You know, and I hope someday someone gets the guts to get around to ripping these games a new asshole. But, you know, the Nintendo old school 1980s console, the games were ass. They did release one good game in Japan, but apparently never decided to bring it to America where the movie was made. And there was also the new Back to the Future game, which was released in 20-something, and it sucks balls. It's terrible. It's basically an old click-and-point adventure. It's boring, confusing, and it has a habit of locking up frames here and there, and the audio cuts out, too. But the good news is Christopher Lloyd took the time out of his busy schedule to cash another check. He enters the cafe where he vandalizes their phone book, and then he's grilled to buy something. He asks for a tab. The joke here is tab is a kind of soda that was popular in that era. The gentleman behind the counter thinks he wants to start a tab for billing. Then he requests a Pepsi Free. As I stated before, Pepsi Free was a caffeine-free Pepsi that was popular in the 1980s for like a minute. And the diner gentleman doesn't know what that is either, so two awesome jokes lost to the ravages of time. He meets Crispin Glover, who is being harassed by Biff. Now there's an awesome moment of social commentary where a young Mayor Goldie Wilson decides he's gonna run for mayor. The diner guy says, "A colored mayor, that'll be the day." Which was a very common view back in those days. Black people weren't accepted as leaders. It was considered inappropriate. Which, 30 years later, in 1985, he is mayor, and no longer considered taboo. A quick moment in the movie, but a powerful example of the difference between where Marty has come from and where he is now. So Marty chases his dad, and he gets a preview of why his dad's on Megan's Law. And he falls out of the tree, and Marty saves him and gets hit by a car. He wakes up in the bedroom of a teenage version of his mother. She flirts with him and then talks about his purple panties, and we meet the family. Marty's grandfather is fixing a TV, and they have dinner, and then Marty's mom tries to grab his junk, and he bolts. He finds Doc, who is wearing the Epcot Center on his head. He explains the situation, and after some fighting, he shows him the time machine, and he's happy as a pig in shit that it actually works. Then there's some classic Back to the Future moment. 1.21 gigawatts! Doc realizes that Marty has fucked everything up, so they create a plan to get his parents back together. No one seems to notice that the white-haired pedophile wandering the halls, and then, another awkward moment where Marty's mom soils her 1950s panties for her son, and after 3.5 hours of the movie is spent, trying to convince Crispin Glover to make out with Leah Thompson. Marty pisses off Biff, so he runs away, and then he steals a kid's scooter. Actually, watch this scene. The kid on the other scooter immediately turns to protect the scooter before even seeing Marty go for it. A small error in the movie, but it still irritates the shit out of me. And then we have the classic scene where Biff and company try to murder Marty in a public view, and shit! Doc seems to have found the time to create a scaled version of Hill Valley when he runs a toy car through it and it blows up, which damn near destroys his home. I have no idea why he does this. What did he think he was gonna do, introducing electricity to a toy car? It was completely pointless. And Stalker Mom finds him and asks him out.
Is it really a screen used DeLorean from Back to the Future 3?
Yeah, it was sitting on the back lot.
Back to the Future also created an entire genre of fucking huge man boys, including Seth MacFarlane, who actually has a replica. And there's also people who have bought the original cars, and there's people who have had conversions done to DeLoreans. I mean, I think that more and more DeLoreans are going to go through this treatment as time goes on. Pardon the pun. But, you know, more and more people are going to try to convert them over to look like the Back to the Future car. There's a number of them out there on the road already. And every once in a while, you'll see somebody pop up on the internet who's taken a picture of, you know, the DeLorean from Back to the Future when it's nothing more than just another knockoff. And then there's the folks who actually own the shit. There's guys who spend countless amounts of fucking dollars just to get a hold of the actual merchandise. And back to Crispin Glover.
Extraterrestrial from the planet Vulcan.
And back to Doc. And then we see more classic 1950s African Americans dressed in aluminum foil. Marty pulls up with his incestuous mother, where they pull out some booze and cigarettes, and Marty's mom busts out her sexy-ass cleavage and jumps his jock and forces her tongue down his neck canal. Biff shows up and tries to rape Marty's mom. They toss Marty into the trunk of the band's car, and they call the guy a spook, which was a racial slur for black folk back in that era. And there's a quick marijuana joke, and they call the black guys reefer addicts. And keep in mind, this era, there was a lot of misinformation about weed and its effects.
Smoke weed every day.
People in that era honestly believed that use of marijuana could lead to insanity. So George McFly belts Biff right in his fucking face. Ugh, most satisfying punch in cinematic history. And without any reason, everybody at the dance shows up outside. They never explain why so many people spontaneously appear, but it doesn't matter. George McFly has his foot in the door of Lorraine's panties, and instead of walking around people, Marty decides to pull a dick move and run right in between two people. And here's Doc working on his shit again. And here's Marty playing at the dance. Lorraine asks George to kiss her, but God, fuck, Marty's mom is a goddamn slut. This part makes me laugh because Marty raises his hand up to see it vanish, but it's obviously superimposed over the footage, and there's absolutely no way that that could be his hand at that angle. I mean, look at this. His forearm would reach his ankle if that was his hand. And George and Leah Thompson. Then we are treated to a scene of Michael J. Fox lip syncing to what is obviously not his voice. Way down in Louisiana, down in New Orleans. Way back up in the woods among the evergreens. There stood a log cabin made of earth and wood. Where lived a country boy named... And Marty rocks out with his cock out, and everybody stops dancing to silently judge him. Marty says goodbye to his parents and gets back downtown to take the 10:05 train to Futureville. There's a few minutes of amazing writing as the cables detach and Doc has to work last minute to connect them. Real palm-sweating goodness. And 10:05, shit explodes. And Marty is slingshot into the future. One of the things that bugs me about this is there's 60 seconds in a minute. How did they know it was going to be the exact moment that the clock got hit? They do state that it was exactly 10:05 p.m., but I don't see no second hand on the clock. Well, whatever, they succeeded, that's all that matters. Marty throws himself down the hill rather than walk down it, and runs into dead Doc. Just kidding, he's alive. Doc drives him home. I'm curious what happened to the Libyans. Did they just leave them there? I mean, were they hurt? Were they dead? Did the police show up? Who knows? Doc bolts his ass off to the future, and Marty heads home for some well-deserved masturbation and sleep. He cock-teases Doc.
Oh, man, watch that re-entry. It's a little bumpy.
You bet. I
know, this is heavy.
The original ending to Back to the Future was actually quite different. Instead of the lightning bolt into the back ass end of the car, what they actually were going to do is have a scene where Marty drove through one of those fake 1950s test, you know, bomb areas and run directly into a nuclear blast, which kind of was like, you know, well, it was like one of those reminders of what it was like in the 1950s. Everybody was in the duck and cover, you know, nuclear war was going to break out at any point in time sort of mindset. So it was kind of like a throwback to the 1950s, but they discovered through, you know, doing the whole business end of it that they just weren't going to be able to afford it. So this ending actually ended up getting scratched. Now Marty wakes up again and can't remember any of it, fist deep in his own ass, and he finds his family is completely different. I kind of feel bad for Marty because his entire history until now has been changed and he can't remember any of it. So one of the more bizarre sets of dialogue happens.
Although, if it wasn't for him,
we never would have fallen in love.
That's right.
We would have never fallen in love If it wasn't for Biff. Yeah, if Biff didn't try to rape you, we would have never fallen in love. What the fuck? Marty finds that he's now the owner of a dream car, which has apparently been parked by an Asian, or a woman, or an Asian woman. Then Marty and Jennifer are about to kiss, and Doc cock blocks Marty again. He Doc blocks him. He smashes into a garbage can, which doesn't seem to grab the attention of Marty's family or the neighborhood. Doc, dressed as Ronald McDonald, tells Marty that he has to do something about his kids because they're all fucked up. Quick, get in the car, because time travel won't allow for a few minutes of waiting for an explanation.
What are you talking about? What happens to us in the future? What, we become assholes or something?
No.
Wait a minute, Doc. What are you talking about? What happens to us in the future? What, we become like jerks or something?
No.
And in complete contrast to his position of not affecting the future, he grabs Marty and Jennifer and fly off to 2015. Where we're going, we don't need roads. Do we become assholes or jerks or something?
To be continued, right now.
Back to the Future 2 came out 4 years later in 1989. The world was in the midst of change. Reagan had left office, but was replaced by the lame duck Vice President George Bush Sr.
Read my lips. No new taxes. I will keep America moving forward, always forward, for a better America, for an endless, enduring dream and 1,000 points of light. This is my mission, and I will complete it.
People were getting prepared for the best part of the 1990s, the beginning. The day that the film came out in West Beirut, a bomb exploded near the motorcade of Lebanese President René Mayoued, killing him, which was a world-changing and growing, and people wanted something new, something different, so Robert Zemeckis gave them Back to the Future 2. A brand new spin on the previous movie while maintaining its own independence. There were two modifications to the cast. First and most notably, George McFly tossed down his ninja smoke ball and has vanished. Crispin Glover, the actor who played George, did not return because they wouldn't give him the money he wanted. So they told him to go fuck himself and instead slap prosthetics onto another actor and didn't let George McFly get too close to the camera, I guess. And so Glover sued them, and due to the lawsuit, there's actually clauses now in the Screen Actors Guild in their agreements which disallow such methods to reproduce the likeness of other actors. The second was Claudia Wells, who played Jennifer Parker. Her mom was sick, so she sat this one out. And in an effort of total awesomeness, they actually redid the entire ending scene of Back to the Future. It was reproduced shot for shot with the new actress, Elizabeth Shue. And I'll let you decide which one's hotter. Take your time. But if you answered Claudia Wells, you win.
How about a ride, mister?
How about a ride, mister?
Jennifer.
Oh, you a sight for sore.
Let me look at you.
Marty, you're acting like you haven't seen me in a week.
I haven't.
You okay?
Are you okay?
Is everything all right?
Oh, yeah. Everything's great.
And there he is. Fake Crispin Glover. Let me explain real fast why Glover didn't make a return. Glover was offered a really shitty amount, less than half of what the other actors were gonna get. And I have to agree with him, that's kind of a dick move on their part. And slapping a Crispin Glover mask onto some guy and filling the role out was kind of a dick move too. Don't worry, Crispin, I got your back, dog. So Doc shows up like the asshole that he is, destroying the McFly trash cans. Wow, those people had a lot of fucking garbage. I mean, look at all that shit. Way to destroy the environment, you assholes. And Christopher Lloyd, Michael J. Fox, and the new girl redo the entire ending sequence and then take off for the future.
Where we're going, we don't need roads.
Yeah, you said that already, jackass. They get shit out in 2015 to the realm of flying cars. Now Jennifer gives this Oscar award-winning dialogue.
Why, we can actually see our future. Doc, now you said we were married, right? Yeah. Was it a big wedding? Marty, we're going to be able to see our wedding.
Wow.
I'm going to be able to see my wedding dress.
Wow.
God, I wonder where we live. I bet it's a big house with lots of kids and... How many kids?
Doc gets jealous of all the attention Jennifer is giving Marty, so he knocks her out. And the excuse why? No one should know too much about their future. Then why the fuck take them to the future, you fucking idiot? Marty asks the obvious question.
Then what did you bring her for?
Obviously, noticing that Doc is completely full of shit. Doc takes the wheel and turns it real quick to the left, and that makes him exit to the right, over a very dark hill valley. You figure with it being dark that someone would turn on a light, but what the fuck ever, who cares? Anyway, Doc lands and makes a quick joke about the postal service like there's still gonna be one in 2015. Doc flirts with Marty about his face, and thus paving way for the director to save money on makeup costs for Christopher Lloyd. And they have some more interactions, and then Doc asks Marty to take off his shirt. Hey, is that a phone booth? Doc furthers his plan to claim Marty's heart by suggesting that they dump Jennifer in an alley for no apparent reason. I mean, he could have easily left her in the fucking car, but instead he leaves her out for Lord Humongous and crew to rape. Doc gives him a big speech about not fucking with anything, which is in vast contrast to the whole point of bringing him to the future to begin with. I mean, if you didn't want him to interact with the future, don't bring him for the love of fuck. I mean, you could have just told him in 1985, oh, by the way, if you raise your kids right, they won't end up in fucking jail. But no, he concocts this asinine plot to use Marty as a doppelganger for his son, just simply to say no. I mean, fuck, Doc. This would have been easy if you just told Marty's kid, hey, that shit that you're planning on doing, don't fucking do that. And if he decides to anyway, break into his room in the middle of the night in a radiation suit and torture him with bad music. We learn that Marty's stupid son gets 15 years for theft. That's a damn long stretch for theft. Marty asks the obvious question, are we just gonna leave her here in the fucking alley alone? And Doc decides to leave her in the alley unsupervised when he could have easily left her in the car. You're a fucking idiot, Dr. Brown. Then we're treated to another classic Back to the Future reveal shot, mirroring the one in 1955. This is another prime example of why Robert Zemeckis is a fucking genius. And 1,000 times better than the people fucking directing these CGI-filled cluster fucks that are in cinemas now. This single scene of Marty in the future captures the hearts and the imagination of children and adults alike, rather than capturing their wallets and stealing the precious hours of their lives. This Texaco rattles off in a 1980s text-to-speech program, and a giant late 1980s computer-generated shark tries to bite Marty's nuts. Then Mayor Goldie Soul Train Wilson III tells people that traffic is a thing of the past. Remember that. Marty checks out a window with some old Nintendo games, an old Mac, and Roger Rabbit toys, which is another movie by Robert Zemeckis. And oh my god, Dragnet, the 1987 floptastic voyage into the realm of horrible directing. That movie is so fucking bad it hurt. No. Marty segues into a Cafe 80s, which is greeted by, well, it looks like a computer animated Ronald Reagan, in the style of Max Headroom. Max Headroom was a 1980s meme of a guy with a plastic head, and he would make quick cuts and audio modifications, and the future TVs are paying tribute to that era which is a joke kind of lost on people under the age of 30. And then Ronald Reagan splits screen with Ayatollah Khomeini, the dick leader of Iran in that era, and he's also Sean Connery. Then there's also Michael Jackson on this one, as this movie predates the stigma Michael Jackson got in 1993. Quick product placement for Pepsi, and we're introduced to two kids wearing whatever they had available in the costumes department. Also, this kid is none other than Frodo Baggins himself, Elijah Woods, who is making his acting debut here. He is also at his lifetime maximum height, if I'm not mistaken. The game that Marty's playing here is Wild Gunman, a Nintendo game that was released in 1974, and then a different version was released to arcades and to home consoles in the 80s. The original one actually had some actual real footage, where you kind of had to hold a gun and then try to shoot at the right time, but you know, the later version was more, you know, it was pixelated, and they used like the 8-bit graphics that Nintendo was using in the 80s. But this version right here that they're showing in the Cafe 80s actually doesn't even exist. This game isn't real. It's just all that you're seeing right here is actual, you know, it's animation that they did for this movie, because the actual version is more pixelated. Marty's kid, also played by Michael J. Fox, gets beat up and acts like Matthew Broderick in The Producers. Tom Wilson, who plays all the Tannins, absolutely owns the character of Griff, who's just batshit crazy. And we're treated to a chase scene, just like the one in Back to the Future 1, except in 2015, and a magnificent homage to the original movie. Marty once again grabs a strange child and steals their mode of transportation. Marty grabs the Jeep from Jurassic Park there, and then we're told that, hoverboards don't work on water. Duh, you bojo.
Unless you've got power! Unless you've got power! Unless you've got power! Unless you've got power!
Unless you got power! Unless you got power! Unless you got power!
I love the cars in Marty's 2015. I mean, if things keep going the way that they are currently, these slick, awesome-looking cars will be replaced by this horseshit. Griff and company also do a bone-fracturing flying leap through the window and come out unscratched. Oh look, the time has changed, and we can be sure that Marty Jr. would never be involved in a self-destructive behavior again. And Marty climbs out of the water and then walks up the stairs from underground for some reason. Then a pedophile tells him to commit more time-fracturing crimes by betting on sports. Yeah, great idea, double tie guy. Then we're forced to deal with more of Doc's stupid moments. He pulls up and this happens.
Hey, Doc, what's going on?
Stand by, I'll park over there.
Couldn't you have just landed it and went, just called it a win? I mean, fuck Doc, is it so hard to keep up with your retarded moments? Doc takes a picture of Charizard, and they find the cops about to cart Jennifer off. You know, this wouldn't have to happen if you didn't leave her alone in a fucking alley while you knocked her out, you fucking morons.
What do we tell them? Are we time travelers?
No! They can scan her thumb, they can scan Marty's too. And then they can just grab her, toss her in the fucking car. Use some common sense. Ugh.
Jennifer could meet herself! Disastrous!
Yet Biff can do it as much as he likes. Anyway, the Skyway is jammed. Didn't Goldie X say the traffic wasn't an issue, you lying motherfucker? So they're off to Hilldale, where the sewers are paved with neon, and the batons have neon, and police hats have taken on the jobs usually done by blimps. And we have Michael J. Fox in drag. Then we're treated to,
Daddy threw him out when he called him a chicken.
Why the fuck would anybody repairing a TV, call somebody a chicken. Oh, that's right. It's a way to segue into the fact that Marty can't handle people thinking he's afraid. I'm unsure why Doc feels the need to go sneaking around me. For fuck's sake, Marty had already traveled through time. He told Doc to look him up in the future. Couldn't he just knock and go, "Hey, it's your old pal Doc, remember me? Could you turn a blind eye while I smuggle someone out of your house?" No, Doc has to keep up this appearance of attempting not to fuck with natural events, which he ignored earlier by having Marty play the role of his son. Wait a second. They have a time machine. Why didn't they just travel back before Jennifer got picked up? Then he could have shocked Marty's son a second time, and then he wouldn't have shown up at the Cafe 80s. Fuck.
Hi, son.
Dad, what the hell happened? You throw you back out again?
Oh, I was out on the golf course. And...
Dad, I told you to watch that backswing.
No, he was hit by a car. It just fell out of the sky.
In Back to the Future 2, they never explained the entirety of the story involving George McFly and why he's upside down hanging from a fucking retarded thing. It's actually the fact that he was out playing golf and a car fell out of the sky and hit him, which they never really explained because they actually ended up cutting that scene from the movie entirely. So it's a little detail, but it's lost the time. Back to the Future 2 predicts the future rather well here by showing a flat screen TV mounted on the wall and the ability to see multiple channels. They even predicted the decline of television's hold on youth. Oh, whatever. So Doc goes off to rescue Jennifer and Marty decides to stand in the middle of the fucking street facing away from the time machine for a good few minutes so Biff can steal it. He also seems to have lost his sense of hearing as Biff crashes into everything nearby. Then Flea from Red Hot Chili Peppers appears on Marty's TV. No joke, that is Flea from Red Hot Chili Peppers. Also, more future predictions as all of the person's personal information is displayed on the screen. Thanks, Facebook! All the futuristic dot matrix printers defecate, you're fired, and Biff appears in an obviously prop car, and he has a heart attack. What actually ended up happening to Biff, rather than, just kind of killing over and dying like it's shown in this image, there's actually a cutscene to show you what ended up happening to Biff, which is he actually started to vanish in the 2015. So, it wasn't added in because I guess they were trying to avoid, images of death and destruction, but it was kind of a neat little thing, and I'm kind of sad that they didn't toss it in there because it shows that, his actions had consequences. They're almost instantaneous. Why did he feel the need to return to 2015? I mean, since when was Biff a guy who cared about being sneaky? I mean, he could have just left them there in 2015. Just watch this small moment where the car lands. I mean, look at that. Done completely without computers. This movie is fucking awesome. Marty heads home after a long day of destroying the timeline and hops in his window to find his family's been replaced by black people. Crispin Glover's cousin, Danny Glover, tries to turn Marty into a pate, and Marty bolts. And then we're treated to a third version of this scene where Marty crosses the street and almost gets hit. We are shown Biff's casino, which is apparently surrounded by a third world nation. This is a bit off, considering most casinos are nice, clean, bright places with security. This casino is a diamond sitting in a turd, but whatever. This spot in the movie actually had a scene where Marty runs into his older brother, who seems to become a street bum. Sorry you got cut from the movie, dog. It's also right next to a toxic waste plant, where all the poisonous fumes would float up into the casino where Biff lives, I guess. Marty meets his mom's tits, and Biff yells a bunch. Here's more classic Back to the Future detail-oriented goodness. These three thugs are the same three thugs from 1955. And we also find out Crispin Glover is dead, which is why he wasn't in this movie. Doc explains on a chart the time shift because apparently Marty is retarded. He confronts Biff in a hot tub with two soggy 80s broads, and then tries to kill Marty. And Tom Wilson rocking the scene again with his psychotic nature. I mean, it's perfection. Biff gets smacked in the fucking mouth with a DeLorean door. A DeLorean. Since it doesn't matter, you know, since this timeline won't exist when they fix it, why not just grab Biff and toss his ass over the side of the building? I mean, or shoot him with a gun. Or shoot him with the gun and then toss his ass over the side of the... Oh, missed opportunity. Off to 1955 again. Marty says it was like I was here yesterday. True dumb Marty. I mean, let me go through the chain of events real fast. Marty leaves 1955 to go to 1985. He sleeps until 10:28 in the morning. He gets up, sees a truck parked all retarded in his garage, and then Doc shows up. They go to the future, and then they stay in the future until nighttime. Then he goes back to 1985 at night. They dick around in the 1985 that's alternate, and then head back to 1955 within a few hours. So it's not like it's been a little more than a day. I mean, it was damn near yesterday that he was there. So when he says, "It was like I was here yesterday," he sounds like a fucking retard. Anywho, Marty dresses like a blues brother. Biff shouts out a trailer park mating call.
Yes, you will! It's you and me, Lorraine! It's meant to be! I'm gonna marry you someday, Lorraine! Someday you'll be my wife!
And we find him in his car. The older him in the car. They go home. He gives them the book. Marty is locked in the garage. Then they go to the dance. Marty stalks Biff, mistakenly thinks that Strickland has the book. Then he ends up watching himself on stage. Notices that Biff's goons are on the other side of the stage and they're gonna jump his other self. And he responds by causing more internal injuries on them. Fuck, Marty. They fly up in the DeLorean and then there's a tense battle to the death inside the tunnel. And Biff tries to murder Marty again, and then Doc uses his magical powers of clairvoyance to drop Marty a lifeline just in time. They burn the book, and Biff smashes into a truck of shit again. Another classic Back to the Future moment as Marty burns the book, and the Biffco Empire vanishes in place of his auto detailing business. And...
Heavy. Hello, and thanks for coming to the Institute of Future Technology.
The Back to the Future ride was fucking epic. I must have been probably about 12 years old when I first went on it. We went on a vacation to Universal Studios in Florida, and it was just... The line was just amazing long. We were probably in that line for most of the day because we went and... rode it twice, and each time it was about 2, maybe 2.5 hours. That's serious. That was a long-ass line until we discovered how to cut through lines, which came at a much later date. Anyway, the Back to the Future ride was, it was a culmination of Universal Studios and different producers and such, and they got Christopher Lloyd back playing his role as Doc because apparently any time that he's got a chance to play Doc and cash a paycheck, he's on that shit. There was the animated show, and then there was this, and then there was the video game. I mean, if he has a chance to be Doc Brown, he's Doc Brown. But anyway, like, it's kind of hard to explain what the ride was like because you can only see video of it, but it was actually a fully interactive experience. It had, you sat inside of a DeLorean, which was nothing more than a prop, and the lap bar came down and it lifted up, and it, as the camera changed, the vehicle would shift and alter, and then you'd go through the ice age, and then you'd go through the lava stage, And it had like little heaters and coolers to shoot cold and hot air at you. It was pretty damn cool. And what ended up happening is over time, you know, people just kind of lost interest in Back to the Future. You know, the trilogy was gone for a long time and people were moving on. And I think it seems that they actually replaced it with the Simpsons ride, which, I don't know, I've never actually gotten around to going back there to check it out because, you know, to spoil something that good and to, like, take that memory away is just rude, and I'm mad at them, so fuck them. Fuck you, Universal Studios, you ruined my childhood. So what would happen is you'd stand in line for 3.5 hours, and there'd be various TVs around the lines. There'd be various TVs around the lines, and you'd see all these clips from Back to the Future 1, 2, and 3, and then there's ladies that would appear on the monitors to, you know, welcome you to the Doc Brown Institute of Future Technology, and then you'd get up to the actual entryway, and you'd step inside of an elevator, and inside the elevator there's all kinds of props. There's I remember that they had the Pepsi Perfect bottle in the knick-knack cabinet that was in the elevator, and all kinds of neat shit. And while you're in the elevator, Doc Brown would come up on the TV and he'd start yapping his mouth off, and I don't think that the elevator actually went anywhere. I think it was just something you stepped inside and it shook. But then you would get into the room, and there'd be the DeLorean in the middle of the room, an 8-passenger DeLorean, which is just, you know, a 4-person bench in the front, 4-person bench in the back, in something that looked a lot like a DeLorean. And then what would happen is they would shoot fog out from under the car, and the entire, like, there'd be walls that were around it like you were sitting in a garage. Then the walls would come down, and what would happen is you would see out to a IMAX projector. It was a movie that would play while the car shifted and floated around. And I remember sometimes, like, when I was on the ride, I would lift my head up a little higher than I should, and I would look over the side, and what it was like a stadium. And this stadium had multiple rides, you know, all these different people and their fake DeLoreans, you know, floating around and gyrating and moving. And it was just a really neat experience. And then you'd go through the whole process of chasing Biff through time, and then you'd smack him in the ass, he'd go back to the Institute, and that was the end of the ride. And, you know, they played some Huey Lewis, and then you were out the door to try to wait another 3.5 hours to get on the ride again. And I remember out front of it, they had the train from Back to the Future 3, and it was a full-scale, honest-to-God train, and they moved it to Universal Studios. And I'm kind of wondering whatever happened to that. I'm sure some asshole collector is going to suck it up like they always do. Then Doc gets hit by lightning, and Marty is stuck in 1955. Again. And it begins to rain, with the most threatening package delivery guy of history. He holds a 70-year-old letter out in the rain, just so it can turn to pulp as Marty starts to read it. Then, ignoring the fact that he could grab a ride with the package delivery guy, he runs to Hill Valley in the rain to inform 1955 Doc that he fucked up and got himself marooned again. And thus ends Chapter 2. What's cool about the end of this film is that when you went to see it in the theater, they actually showed you a trailer for the next film. I mean, as a little kid in the theater, I remember seeing this happen. It was magical. Thank you, Robert Zemeckis. I love you.
To be concluded, right now.
The third movie opens with the old-style Universal logo. We get lucky again that they replay the last scene from the previous movie, just like the previous movie. It's a perfect setup. Marty scares the shit out of Doc by announcing his return from the future, and in response, Doc falls the fuck over unconscious. One thing I haven't mentioned that I love about these movies is the initial credit sequence at the beginning of each film, and the mood that it sets for what's coming. I mean, Back to the Future It started with the TV report and the clock setting up the information that would come into play later, and then in Back to the Future 2, there was this ride through the clouds that signified that we're in the future and the sky is the limit. And Back to the Future 3 starts off with a slow, relaxing, raining sequence, making you feel at ease after the two movies of adrenaline-pumping, palm-sweating action. We're woken by Howdy Doody, a television show in the 1950s featuring a puppet. Doc starts rambling like a schizophrenic to himself, and then Marty surprises him, and more amazing writing here. As Doc falls back onto the organ, playing notes of doom, that is just great. Marty attempts to explain to him how he keeps fucking up in every time period he's in. They mirror the same scene from Marty meeting 1955 Doc from the first film, even calling Marty Future Boy. Doc ignores the previous issue that he had reading something that told his future by reading the letter that he wrote to Marty. Okay, so the flying circuits are fried. Does that mean that when Doc arrived in 1885, he just dropped from the sky? I mean, how did the car survive? How did he survive? Doc writes very specifically that he doesn't want Marty to come save him. Doc says, "They would have burnt me at the stake." Yeah, maybe if you were in Europe. I mean, the Native Americans wouldn't have had a problem with you. They would have worshipped you as a god, and you would have spent the rest of your life balls deep in Pocahontas. Doc and Marty go deep inside of Doc's cave where they locate the DeLorean. Doc makes a racist remark, and they load up a 70-year-old DeLorean.
No wonder this circuit failed. It says made in Japan.
And oh no, Doc is dead, and change of plans, off to the past to fuck shit up worse. Jesus fucking Christ, Mark. After you fix the DeLorean and replace the tires, I'm bringing you home. Yeah, you're fucking lazy. Marty says, after you fix the DeLorean and replace the tires, I'm bringing you back home. I mean, how fucking lazy are you? Once you replace the tires, he's building circuitry. You can change the fucking tires, you lazy ass. Doc fires a gun off that he should have given to Marty, and he's off to destroy more of the future. Indians! They're called Native Americans, you fucking racist. Marty gets all up in the cave, and the desert cave-dwelling brown bear scares the shit out of him. Marty does a nosedive off a cliff and knocks himself out. It appears that his farm was right around the corner. I mean, what happened to all the Indians and the cavalry that just went through? They just straight up vanish? What? Because fucking Seamus doesn't seem to know where the hell they are. Whatever. Marty does a nosedive off a cliff, knocks himself out, and another mirror scene is done. Now here's a scene that bugs me a bit. Leah Thompson, who played Marty's mother in the first two films, is now playing the role of his great-great-grandmother, Maggie McFly. Now that might not strike you at first, but remember, Marty's mom wasn't a McFly, she was a Bates. Seamus McFly, Marty's great-great-grandfather, should resemble Marty. Maggie should not look like Marty's mom's side of the family, unless incest comes into play, which isn't completely out of the question in this trilogy. So Marty is at the McFly farm, which is pretty impressive since Strickland says that no McFly ever amounted to anything. You lying fuck. And Maggie gets pissed off, and Marty goes to town and watches men bathe and sees the courthouse being built. He plows through some horse shit and heads into a bar to track it all over the place. Marty meets Mad Dog Tannen. They taunt him and Marty pisses him off and then dumps a spittoon of saliva and tobacco on him. Marty nearly knocks some dude off of his horse, and that would probably have killed him, destroying the future for someone else. I mean, what if that was Jennifer's whatever the fuck. They attempt to homicide Marty to death, and Doc exposes his position as a spawn camper. What idiot dressed you like that? You did. Apparently, Doc can't remember back to 1955. I mean, maybe it's a timeline thing, but wait, couldn't he remember Marty in 1985 after his first trip to 1950. Ah! Doc takes him home, and Doc gets all kinds of offended as Marty is suggesting that he might have a girlfriend. He finally has Marty where he wants him, and no woman can tear a hole in their love. Oh yeah, and Marty tore a hole in the gas tube, and they're both royally fucked. Except for one thing, gasoline is a byproduct of distilling petroleum. Petroleum had started being drilled in America 26 years earlier in Pennsylvania. First Continental Railroad was finished 15 years later. Both of these would be known by Doc, who can make the world's first ice cube. So all they needed to do was get the DeLorean, take it to the railroad, load it up, take it to Pennsylvania, buy some petroleum, distill it, pop it in the car, and boom, off to 1985. But no, Doc opts into the plan to destroy everything and goes the fucking complete opposite direction as the common sense route. So they try horses at first, whose top speed is around 40 miles an hour, which Doc admits, and then Doc fills the tank with whiskey, which blows part of the 70-year-old DeLorean's ass off. And so Doc comes up with the batshit plan to use a train. Doc talks fourth dimensionally, but ignores California is on a fault line, and the general age of the railroad tracks and such. There's a likelihood that when the car appears in 1985, it would clip the tracks or appear inside of the tracks, ripping the car the fuck apart. Doc, you are a fucking anus. And the Pearlman, I mean Mary Steenburgen, is about to get murdered by horses when Doc saves her. She's supposed to be 30, but she looks like she's 50, and Doc is between 70 and 75 years old, and so the creepy romance starts. Marty cock blocks Doc for one, and we're treated to another one of Doc's shitty models. Then ZZ Top tears it up 1885 style. Doc and Marty get their picture taken with a clock that'll get zapped 70 years from now, and Clara shows up and Doc stares at her like a jogger rapist. And Marty murders the fuck out of some fake people when Mad Dog and Troop show up. Mr. Strickland's ancestor, Marshall Strickland, tells Biff, guns or get the fuck out, with a shotgun to his face. There's actually a cut scene from Back to the Future 3 where Tannen and company actually kill the Marshal, but they removed it because they thought it was too damn sad. Marty makes note of the Frisbee pie plate. There used to be this half-true urban legend that Frisbees were created from people using Frisbee pie plates as, well, Frisbees. And however, it's unlikely that these plates would have made it to Southern California as they came from Connecticut, but mostly just a plot device. I guess it can be ignored. Mad Dog pulls out the world's smallest gun and attempts to kill Doc, and he triggers the Marty switch of courage by calling him Yella. They arrange a playdate and Mad Dog splits. Doc acts creepy some more. Oh yeah, and the name is disappearing off the tombstone in this picture, much like the picture where Marty and his siblings vanished in the first Back to the Future. Doc announces that he's gonna stay behind in 1885, Marty smacks some sense into him, and they prepare the DeLorean. Doc announces he's going back to the future to Clara, and she gets pissed off, so Doc gets shit-faced. They try waking him up when Biff, I mean Mad Dog Tannen, shows up. Marty checks the photo to see that he's gonna get killed-ified. Marty finally realizes that he doesn't always have to respond and gracefully hauls his ass out the back door. They hold Doc hostage and then Clara attempts to murder a train full of people. And here comes Marty to confront Mad Dog. Mad Dog murders Marty. LOL, JK, Marty risks his life with a tiny piece of metal and gives Mad Dog an extreme beatdown. Manure makes its appearance for this film as Mad Dog does a nosedive into the cart of it. They bolt ass for the train because now that Mad Dog is going to be hung, there's no way that they couldn't wait for another train. Plot hole! I mean, also, like, what? I guess that Mad Dog must have had a wife and a kid already, because, you know, if he didn't have a kid, then the Tannen line would end and then Biff wouldn't exist. So I really hope that he had a kid. Anywho, whatever. So Clara goes off to destroy their plan as they steal the train. The Back to the Future cartoon was awful. It took place, obviously, after the entire trilogy, and it was neat because there was actually segments that starred Christopher Lloyd and him just being his crazy-ass self, but the cartoon was just stupid, and it starred cheesy Marty McFly and cheesy Doc and cheesy Clara, and oh good, there's a dog that can honk a horn. And it's just, ugh, it was just terrible. And it was like they tried to give these kids, like, personalities, which in the movie they had none. They were just silent and stood there and looked uncomfortable. Other than that, the cartoon really isn't worth mentioning. It's kind of just a throwback to the era. But, yeah, it was the one thing that they tried to capitalize on TV, and it just didn't work at all. And they even had a comic book at one point, too, that was just as awful. Doc tosses in the magic fire logs, and Clara pulls the whistle and damn near falls off the damn thing. Oh, fucking women. Can't you do anything right? At 1/4 of a mile, at the speed they're going, let's see, they would be in the range of 15 to 25 seconds until they hit the end of the tracks. Doc misses the train, and thus, he misses the future. Marty appears in the future just in time to not get hit by the train. Shit, if they had the time circuits just 10 seconds earlier, Marty could have gone boom and gone right through the train head on. The train liquefies the time machine and then continues without stopping to make sure that people are okay. Marty's family runs out to the car while not Crispin Glover hangs out in the far away from the camera. Marty goes to wake up Jennifer, like Prince Charming style, and Jennifer quizzes Marty about whether or not it was real. Then Flea challenges him to a race, and rather than decline the race, he decides to risk him and Jennifer's life by peeling out backwards and flipping his truck around, which could have easily tipped over due to how high the suspension of that vehicle is. Marty takes Jennifer to view the corpse of the DeLorean, which they never cleaned up because the train never stopped or called the authorities. There's a sad, heart-aching moment where they realize that they're just never going to see Doc again. And Doc appears by blowing them on their asses, and they're treated to one of the most heartwarming moments in a movie ever, as Doc and Marty finally get their closure. Taking a look at Vern, he looks really uncomfortable, and it looks like he's trying to gain the attention of someone off the camera. Maybe his mom or his fucking animal handler. Poor kid, look at him. He's even, like, moving his hand and shit. And Marty asks Doc where he's going. Doc says he's off in a flying train. He's already been to the future. And thus, the third chapter of the trilogy comes to an end.
The end. Fucking finally. The end. Fuck yes. The end! Praise the Lord! The end. Hell yeah, motherfucker! The end. What, bitch?
Fuck it, I'm putting all of them in.
The Back to the Future trilogy has had a lasting impact on our world culture. It has been run in damn close to every country and damn near every language. And unlike most classics, it's likely to never be remade or continued. They actually have contracts and such to prevent another movie or a reboot. So this is a classic that will grow old among other movies that have never been redone, like Star Wars or Dracula. It also raises a lot of questions as a trilogy too. A lot of what ifs. You know, what if they hadn't removed all the scenes of death? What if they hadn't, you know, what if they explained minor details better? What if Doc didn't always contradict his every action? What if they used the nuclear test ending? What if Marty was a sexy young teenage girl? I don't think the movies would have been the same. I feel a bit conflicted about any modifications. And it's a story that can't age because it's a time travel movie, and the 1980s will remain alive and well as long as Hollywood respects it as a piece of art. It's not a piggy bank to rape over and over and over again until people never want to hear about it again. And 2015 is coming, and it'll go. Someday this review will be out of date. Maybe a professional will come along and review it, and go into obnoxious detail about every stupid fucking scene. But the movie will live forever. But maybe someday it'll be used in a history class. I mean, that's a pretty fucking awesome idea. Dear educators, feel free to use this video, royalty mostly free, to teach the next generations about the joys of being covered in feces.
And end up being gay.
Why shouldn't you be?
It's now time for the Back to the Future Best Character Battle to the Death. Our first battle, Biff versus Lorraine. Biff uses Psychopath. It's super effective. Lorraine counters with Incest. It's super disgusting. Biff wins. Our second battle, Dr. Emmett Brown versus Clara. Clara starts off with bitchy attitude. It's not very effective. Doc counters with cocaine face. Neither one are making an inch. Clara starts off with guilt trip. Doc counters with get the fuck out of 1885. Winner, Doc. Our third battle, Jennifer A. versus Jennifer B. Jennifer A. uses sexy as fuck. It's a one-hit knockout. Our fourth battle, Marty McFly versus George McFly. George McFly starts off with clowny clown clown. Marty McFly responds with, I got Parkinson's and I'm still classy as fuck. It's super effective. Marty wins. Semi-finals battle one, Biff versus Doc. Doc starts the match off with creepy organ music. It's not very effective. And here's Biff with rape. It's super effective. Biff wins. Semi-finals battle two, Jennifer A versus Marty. Jennifer A uses vanish. Marty uses self-loathing and pity. It's super effective. Marty wins. Final battle. Marty McFly versus Biff. Marty starts off with empty threat. It's a hit. Biff's turn. Biff uses 1946 Ford. It misses. Marty uses Parkinson's. Biff's defenses are down. Biff responds with the question.
Say, hey, was that real manure? No, it wasn't. Was that real manure? No, was that real manure? It's a movie. Stop asking me the question.
Biff wins.